The sixth grade are dismissed to their service. 2 Timothy chapter number 3, for those of us here, 2 Timothy 3. I mentioned last week we handed out an article, the saddest letter I've ever read. Let me ask you a question. How many took time to read that letter? All right, how many of you agree that was a pretty sad letter? It's amazing. Now today, Brother Kerry Schmidt, the one who posted it, he's got five different responses to this letter. And he broke them down. When he originally wrote this years ago, I broke them down over five, I think it was 5 weeks or every other week or things of that nature. So as you leave today, there'll be the first response. And what the response is basically three or four thoughts to think about. And there's not a response. I don't believe it's a young lady looking to get anybody in trouble. I think she's looking for some answers. So he's going to put out five different responses. So every week today you leave, you'll take one of those. You say, why not five in a row? I've read all five. There's just an awful lot to take in and absorb. Some great principles, great truths as you leave. Please grab those and read those and just be a help and a blessing and pray about the truths that are on those different papers that you get. One thing, you heard if you were here at the beginning in the up next video, we have a meeting with parents for the missions trip. Do me a favor. We've had some say, well, I'm not sure if I'm taking my kid or I'm not. We're making some changes. So if you have a teenager, eighth grade and up, all right, and you're at all interested at all, you say, I'm concerned about Brazil. Just come, all right? Just come. I don't want to explain all the changes we're making, but please show up. And if you say, I just don't know something the Lord give me peace about, then that's fine. But we want to give you a chance to talk about some of the changes, logistical things that we have come across in the last 2 weeks. So after the service, I'll be running that meeting with Pastor Troy. It will take a few minutes. Give me a few minutes in the back, and then I'll come up, and we'll go through the meeting real quick and explain what the changes are. And we want your advice. We want your opinion before making any final decisions. 2 Timothy chapter 3, you follow along as I read, beginning in verse number 12. The Apostle Paul is writing this book to a young pastor named Timothy. This is his second letter as he is pastoring a church. In verse 12 of chapter 3, Paul says, under the inspiration of God, he says, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. But evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. And he says this to Timothy, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and hast been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them. Father, we love you. We thank you for the word of God. We're grateful for the truths that we will see this morning. It is easy for us, Father, to put some of these aside. Either I've already reared my kids, no big deal, or I've got this accomplished. And Father, may we, including myself, come this morning, not assuming that we've got it accomplished. Father, may we come desiring to learn, how can I be better in this area? How can I do this better for my wife, for my family, for my kids, for my grandkids, for the next generation? How can I do better? Father, I pray you bless in this hour. In this next half hour, may you use it. I got some scared people out there, Lord, that thinking we're going to go long. I pray, Father, you bless in this time. May it honor you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Some of you are panicking, weren't you? I was thinking about a whole hour, too. 2 Timothy chapter 3 talks about the idea in verse number 14, but continue thou in the things that thou have learned and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou has to learn them, of who you have learned them from. This morning I'm going to preach a message entitled The Power of a Parent's Influence. The Power of a Parent's Influence. One of my favorite things to watch in church and in school is to watch a big elementary program. And the kids come and they stand some around here or up on these steps. And my favorite part is you'll have sometimes the pre-K and the kindergartners in the first and second grade, and they're standing on the front steps. And you all know what I'm talking about. They're doing this. What are they looking for? Their parents. And right in the middle, every time they see their parents' face, they do this. And the teacher, stop, stop, stop. And the parents in the back, oh, it's so cute, he waved at me. Right? It's awesome. It is absolutely awesome. Why? Because the kids just, the parents, man, they're glad they're there. Every once in a while in our school program, a parent will drop a kid off and not stay. And I watch the kids, they're kind of looking at the parent and stay. That's not easy. That's harsh. I always sit back and say, why would you drop your kid off to a kid to their own program and not stay? By the way, parents, don't ever drop your kid off to a program and not stay. You say, that's mean. Okay, let me be nicer. Never drop your kids off at a program and not stay, all right? You are telling them you don't care about all the time they put in. You say that, no, I'm not. Yes, you are. Because the influence of a parent is so powerful. It's not always what I do. Sometimes it's what I don't do that speaks volumes to our children. Each and every one of us would agree that parents probably had some of the greatest influence in our lives growing up. Some of you will say, I am much of who I am because of my parents, because of what they did. Some of you will say, many of the struggles I have in my life are because of my parents. Some can say that. By the way, some parents are great influencers to their kids. Some parents are influencing kids in a way that is so ungodly. Now, if you came out of a home like that, where your parents were the reason in your mind, here's what I encourage you to do in that one situation before we move on, all right? You need to forgive them, forget, deal with your bitterness, and move on. If you really had parents like that, that is not a dealing. But God gave you the parents he wanted you to have. You can learn from that. But don't let that affect. Some people say, I'm like this because I'm, this is who I am because my parents, my shrink told me, and I can live the worst way I want. You know what? Fine. You can if you want to, and you can be miserable and affect everybody else around you because of what someone did to you 10 years ago. Forgive them, let it go. You say, Pastor, you don't know how easy it is. I never said it was easy. It is biblical. You say, if I forgive them, I've let them get away with it. No, God will deal with it. When you forgive them, you're letting yourself free from that bondage. Let it go and move on to the next step so it doesn't continue that same pattern throughout the years. But for much in this room, we would sit back and look at how our parents taught us to play a certain sport. I would say to play a video game, but that's usually not how it goes because, you know, I mean, I was the original Nintendo. You know, the Tecmo Bowl? That was cool stuff back when I was in high school. And my kid watches the commercial, the Tecmo Bowl commercial. Oh, that's disgusting. I remember thinking how awesome it was to play that game. But then again, we had tube televisions, too. Everything was a little different back then. But we learned so much from our parents. The other day, a few weeks ago, I took my son to the firing range and taught him how to shoot. Why? Because I wanted to learn how to do it. We had a blast, all right? I'd rather him than someone else teach him how to shoot. But, you know, that's the idea. Take him, teach him how to do certain things. A lot of things I'll learn to do around the sound system around here. You know, I learned it watching my dad solder and put it together, and he'd plug it in. It'd be a big scream. Okay, not right. He would do it over again. That's how I learned a lot, by watching other people, by the influence of other people. Today we're going to look at the greatest influence God has given us as parents. And how to use that for his glory. By the way, a couple weeks ago, we talked about the fact, remember, this is God's heritage. These are God's children, not mine. All right? Now, if you disagree with that comment, you're going to struggle with the entire series. All right? God gave me children, they're gifts from him, and he wants me to rear them according to his word. That is God's command. If you disagree, we'll sit down later. We can talk about the Bible about that. But it was given to us by God. And then he wants us to use our ability for his honor and glory. Our children, understand this, our children will one day have to decide what they will do with Jesus. Now, by the way, really twofold. Number one, salvation. Will they accept Jesus? But can I tell you, there's a second one. This one sticks a little more to some public school or to Christian school kids. Christian school kids grow up around God all the time. By the time they hit their senior year, sometimes like I just want to be away from it for a little bit. Because for not the Christian school's fault. At some point with your kids, public school, homeschool, Christian school, at some point, your child will have to decide, hopefully if they're saved, I am taking the point that they're saved, what I will do with Jesus. Will Jesus have the place in my life that he should have? They will make that decision, and I will have a huge influence on what decision they will make. 2 Timothy 1, verse 5, the Bible says, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded that in thee also, the heritage that comes back. And he goes back that one of the reasons Timothy became as he was, a verse we did not finish, go back to 2 Timothy 3, verse 15. Paul told Timothy, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make thee wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. He is a pastor now, and it started as a child. I want to look at three things this morning quickly from this passage. Number one, God has given parents the greatest influence in their children's lives. God has given the parents the greatest influence in their children's lives. Proverbs 22, verse 6, a verse we know very well. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. leave that up there for a second. Go back. I'm going to let you look at a couple of things. Train up is the command. That is what I have been given. I've been given them, and I train them up. The church doesn't. The school doesn't. The gangs don't. The public school doesn't. Television doesn't. iPads don't. I do. I train them up. And then the way this should go, it's not, well, I let my kid decide what they're supposed to do. They got to make their own decisions. God told me to point them to God. If I let them make decisions, everybody else is screaming, go this way, go this way. My voice, even though it may not be as many as theirs, is louder. I point them in the right way. And the Bible says when he's old, he will not depart from it. That does not mean your child will never run from God. Here's what that means. When your child is older, the truths they have learned will not escape them. They will never escape the truths that have been placed into their life. It is the command that God has given us with the greatest influence. We've been given this command and an opportunity to teach. So let's look at this. Number one, let's look at, in this part, the power of a parent's influence. There is not a greater influence our children will have than ours, and I believe that with all my heart. I've watched kids in horrible scenarios, like in public schools where they're just being ripped apart. You know what? The parents help them come strong. I've watched kids grow up in what we consider the perfect scenario, Christian home, Christian school, youth group, and all that. And they grow up wanting little to do with God. Why? Because there was a voice in the home more powerful than what they had heard. They have friends. And by the way, teens, be careful the kind of friends you place around you. Parents, can I get an amen? Be careful what kind of friends you hang around. All right? Because they are an influence. They will test what you've been taught. They will push. And let me tell you, I know you're going to be told this. The world says, oh, you should try this, try that. No, don't try it, okay? When someone offers you something you know is wrong, gracefully say, no, I'm not going to take that. And when they say, what are you, weird? Maybe a little bit. But you know what? Can I suggest you don't have to be embarrassed about doing right? All right. A lot of people sit back and say, oh, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do it. One time I was at Chick-fil-A for the very first time I'd ever been offered cigarettes or drugs. We were closing. We're leaving. It was at the Oxford Valley Mall at this time. We were leaving the mall. And a guy caught me. And he goes, you want some? He was a big guy. He's my manager. And I said, no, I don't. What are you, weird? Come on, everybody's doing it. I was a little more obnoxious even at that age, and I looked right at him. I said, not everybody, because I'm not. You think you're smart? I said, you're smoking that junk. I'm a little smarter. He was smoking marijuana or something like that. I think I'm a little smarter. He goes, why aren't you going to do it? I said, because I want to do what's right. My God's told me to stay away from that stuff. You see, that's weird. You preached at him. Why are we so ashamed to do right? It's okay. Now, I'm not saying that your 16-year-old kid needs to preach to other people. All you got to say is, I don't want it. In most cases, they're going to walk away to someone else who does. All right? Be careful the kind of people you place around you, because they will influence your thinking. We have the media. The media is screaming, stay away from God. Have you seen that? Have you watched? It is screaming, stay away from God. It is screaming that what we teach is wrong, it's evil, it's intolerant. It's politically incorrect. Now, I will say much of it is politically incorrect. That's what makes it right. Power is so important about our influence. They have church. Some of them have work. You know, none of these are as powerful as you in their lives. Your voice, even though it may not be as many, they may have 10 friends saying something when one parent, whether they'll admit it or not, has a much greater power in their voice than the other 10 kids. And they will compare everything we say to what other influences will say. Then there's a need of the parents' influence. There's a need of an example. They need us to be the example. They need to see that, yes, we do. We try to do right. We mess up sometimes. That's okay. We deal with it. We move forward. And we messed up. We acknowledge and we move forward. It's not about what happened yesterday. It's about where am I going tomorrow? Is what the kids need to see. They need instruction. They need to know what is right or wrong in these areas. They need help. They need help. How many kids deal with some things they've never told their parents about? They're being just being overwhelmed with some of the problems of the world. They need a parent to help them. So when they come to you and they say, I'm really struggling in this area, they need someone just to help them. Just to acknowledge it's not easy. And to give them some advice. They need encouragement when they're struggling. This follows a little bit what we said last week. The full acceptance of who they are. I'm not trying to make them like me. They do not want to be like me. I don't want them like me, all right? I want them to be them. The need of the parents' influence. Lastly, the need of the tension in our influence. As important as rules are, and rules are important, our teens and our children need our attention even more. Setting the line is needed. Our attention to them as people is even more needed. I'm going to have a rule. I'm going to enforce the rule. And guess what? When I enforce the rule, my kid's going to sit back and say, oh, you're evil. You're a dictator. You're going to hear me say this a couple of times. Every good parent should be called a dictator at least once in their life. All right? If not once a week, okay? Don't be me, but every good parent needs to understand there's a line. You know why I hold that line so strong? Because I know the junk on the other side of that line. And I'm going to hold it because I don't want my kid. Even if I had that junk in my life growing up, there is a thought amongst parents, well, I did that growing up. Why should my kid not? I can't expect him not to. That's exactly why you should expect him not to. Why should they have the same problem you have? I am there to say I've been there. It is so not worth it. And I'm going to hold this line and keep you from it. And when they say, but you did it, and you say exactly, which is why I don't want you there. Hold that line. But when you hold the line and you got to be rough, hold it and then still give them attention. All right, take them to a Phillies game or something. Take them out to eat. Enjoy the time. I've encouraged some parents here to do this. If you're in our school, you have a right. You actually have a right in public school, but I know it's harder for some who work. But I encourage parents to do this. I do this not a lot, but often throughout the year. I'll grab one of my kids and take him out of school, go to lunch. One, it's easy for me. I don't have to pack lunch. All right. Two, there's something special about when that kid's walking out of class. Yeah, I'm going lunch. Where are you going? McDonald's, Charlie's, wherever as they want to go, right? And everybody else is thinking of that delicious peanut butter and jelly sandwich that has been stepped on the way to school. And that's lunch. And we're leaving. And we cut. What's even worse is you bring back the refill of soda when you come back. That's mean. No, I want my kid to know that I want to take some time with him. You say, you're a pastor, you can do that. So I do have that one benefit, but if you have some time, take advantage of it. Pull them out. Just surprise them. Why not? Show them attention. I have to set that line. It's biblical. So I need to give them the attention they need to offset some of the struggle, some of their frustration from them. Let's look at the next second point. A godly influence will give structure to the home and lives. A godly influence will give structure to the homes and lives. Whether we or our children want to admit it, there is a great need of security in structure. 1 Corinthians 14:33. For God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all our churches of the saints. 1 Corinthians 14:40. Let all things be done decently and in order. Now, there is a point where we can go a little too far, okay? But here's my point. Here's what I want to get to. Most people fight this idea of structure. But let me tell you something. There's a passage in Proverbs. I didn't have it on the screen. It says, fathers, provoke not your kids to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And I read an article. My wife read it, showed it to me, an article of one of the ways you provoke your kids to wrath. The word provoke also means frustrate them. And he wrote an article about the area of frustration. And he said, one of the greatest frustrations in a teen home is that today, what I want to do is okay. Tomorrow, that same thing is wrong. Today, it's okay. Tomorrow, it's wrong. They don't know from day to day what's right and what's wrong. Because there's no line as to where we're going to say. So we look, number one, at the dreaded line. The dreaded line. Why do I call it the dreaded line? That is the line and not the political line, okay, all right? The dreaded line of this is the rule. Okay, in television, you can watch, but the line crosses at there's certain programs you cannot watch. There's certain ratings you cannot watch. That is the line. You see, what if they cross the line? Here's the reason most people struggle with the dreaded line. Because that kid, you know what they're going to do? They're going to walk up. And they're not going to walk up and look at the line, all right? They're going to walk right over the line, and they're going to stand there. What you going to do? You know that, right? We see this as rebellion. There is a level of rebellion. But can I tell you one thing they're doing, whether they know it or not? When they hit that line and they cross it, and they do this. They're trying to find out, are you serious about that line? Are you going to hold it? Or are you just going to let me do whatever I want? Here's the important thing. Are my parents afraid of me? Are my parents afraid of me? Are they willing to be the bad guy and not be friendly anymore and enforce that rule? If my kid, they watch something on television, you know what? You don't get TV for a week. What? I know. They're going to call the police. You're going to go to jail for child abuse because you took the TV away. I'm being sarcastic, by the way, okay? One of the reasons kids, well, they know that, and psychologists, Christian psychologists have proven this over and over. One of the reasons teens push the line is they want to find out if it's real. And whether they know it or not, when they find out it's real, there is such security in that line. I'll give you an example. I think I might have told the story before, but my very first summer in youth group, I took a bunch of kids. It was already planned. All I had to do was drive the vehicle. So I get to Bill Rice Ranch in Tennessee. And there's a girl named Jen, and she came to me, and she goes, there's a guy over there, and he likes me, and he wants my number. And I'm like, well, she says, my dad doesn't want me to do this. And you know, and I'm like, well, she's, I don't want to be the bad guy. I don't want to be mean. I don't want to hurt his feelings. I don't know what I want to do. And I said, well, what's your dad say? He goes, well, my dad doesn't want me to. I said, well, then here's your answer. Give him your dad's number. So as they were leaving, she did. Mr. Coates was a former military police officer. She had called him ahead of time. This guy, he won't leave me alone. So, of course, it's after camp, and he calls up, and the phone rings, and I'm guessing, from what I understand, I'm assuming he's excited, and he answers, and all of a sudden he hears, hello? I think I got the wrong number. No, you're looking for Jennifer. That's my daughter. And if you get with it, and he just went into this kid. I think the kid had to change his clothes before he got home from camp. Here's the point. One of the things that is great when a teenager is placed with temptation to do wrong is it's worse at home. My dad will kill me. You say, that's wrong. No, what a great truth that they can tell somebody they don't want to do wrong because of me. I'm fine with that because I've protected them from that. The dreaded line gives security. You know why? Because I know what's coming. I know what's right. I know what's wrong. I know where I can go, and it's there, and my parents are going to hold it lovingly. They're not always just going to scream, well, that may happen some, but they're going to hold it strong and yet lovingly. That dreaded line. We know why. We know what's going on. It's a conflict. Why is this so important? It makes it easier to know what is accepted and what will happen. When your kid gets in trouble, Here's what happens when you're living off emotion. It's more important for parents. Let me tell you why. If I have my kids do something and I have a rule in place, if I don't have the rule in place, here's what happens, all right? My kid has crossed that line, and that line may be 10 feet away, I don't know, but he's broken a rule. I come home, and I have yet to decide what the punishment is for the rule. What happens when I come home? I'm out on a date with my wife. I come home, and I realize they've broken the rule. I'm angry. I'm irritated. I was ready to come home and chill, and they broke it. How dare they? And what do? Boom! And all of a sudden, I rip into my kids in great punishments. Like, you're dead. You got to sleep on the floor until you graduate. Crazy stuff like that. You don't make your bed right, I'm burning it. The kind of stuff like that. And the kids are sitting back, what? They're annoyed. They're frustrated. They're defensive. They're getting angry, and they know everything. They know 80% of what's coming out of your mouth isn't true because you're not going to burn their bed. You're not going to make them sleep on the floor until they're 18. That's why the line's there. All right? If you do this, this is the punishment. Here's the thing. They chose it. I don't have to get upset. They chose it. I move on. It helps me be a little calmer when I deal with the situation. So it's just, that's the deal. You see, is it easy? A little bit. Because when I still do it, I see the look on their face. I see the frustration, the hurt, the tears. And as a dad, I got to go beyond that because of that dreaded line. But here's another reason why. Because of the foundation that is established. The foundation that is established. One of the greatest needs is to teach that there are things that we do and don't do. Some call this standards. I'm not going to push much on the word. But I think there needs to be morals and things we will or will not do in our home. Proverbs 4, 1 through 4. Hear ye children the instruction of a father and tend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine, forsaking not my law. For I was my father's son, tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. He taught me also and said unto me, let thine heart retain my words, keep my commandments and live. One of the most important parts of teaching moral standards, the reasons why, the reasons what we do, is not the what, it is the why. Why don't we watch certain TV programs? Why don't we listen to certain music? Why do we go to church? Why don't we look at these pictures? Why don't we go to these places? Why do we invite people to church? Why do we read our Bible? Why? Let me tell you why the why is more important than the what. If you grow up your entire life knowing my mom and dad said I can't do these things, you know what's going to be in the back of their mind when they graduate? Man, I'm going to go do those five things right now. Because it's just my dad's crazy rules. But if I understand as a teenager why, guess what happens? Now I have to reevaluate when I leave the home. Why don't I do this? Well, now I have a reason. I still may choose to go against it. But it's not just rebellion. I have to go against the truth. And if I give from the Bible, it's even more important. 1 Peter 1:15, but as he which is called you is holy, so be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. This is what will help them the rest of their life. It is so much more needed than rules. This will help them in situations that we are not yet aware of. When I was growing up, many of you, now I'm 40, all right? I'm old. Many of you think that's very young. I appreciate that, okay? But my age and older didn't usually have cell phones until like their mid-20s, okay? And mine came first as a job employee. I was given a cell phone. And back in those cell phones, I remember we had these little clips, and you wore them off your hip. I mean, the smartphones are getting about as big, but they were big bricks, the Nokias, and they hung down there, and if you're not careful, they pulled your pants down. You know, it was crazy. You pull them off in a big old brick, and you didn't text, because texting, no one thought of texting. You just had the freedom to call from anywhere, and the freedom that came, I remember the phone they gave us when digital first came out, and I'm driving a bus, we're driving back from a basketball game, a two-hour drive, and for an hour and a half of it, there was no signal. I'm passing all these cell towers, not one signal. We had a company that doesn't exist anymore by surprise, all right? Like T-Mobile bought them out or something, but it's pointless. And then, a few years later, someone sent me this message on my new phone, and it didn't come across. It was just words. And I'm like, who's trying to sell me something? And I recognized the number. It was somebody I knew. And then I learned about this thing called texting. I was convinced this isn't going anywhere. It takes too much time. 1-1-1-3-3-3-6-6-6, right? Who's going to do that? People could literally, you know, fly with their phone. If they could do math as well as they could text with one hand, we'd be geniuses, I'm telling you. But you know what? When I was 16 in my home, my dad did not sit down and said, Rodney, you need to understand something. When you get into your 30s, they're going to create this thing, a guy named Gates Jobs is going to create this thing called a smartphone. And a smartphone is going to get you data, you're going to get online, and all the things you'd have to get magazines for now are going to be right in front of you on your phone, and you can hide it. So let's talk about how to deal with the smartphone. There was no such thing as a smartphone. I'm back to the future a little bit, but not a real smartphone. Here's the point. Why do I teach the why instead of the what? Because I don't know what my kids will deal with when they're my age. But this doesn't change. So I teach them this. I teach them the why. And by the way, you know what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes? There's nothing new under the sun. Yeah, the phone is new, but the temptation that comes with it, the same when I was 15. I learned the principle, and I apply it even to a smartphone. This is what will help them the rest of their life. So what happens if I don't set a limit? 1 Samuel 3:12. In that day I will perform against Eli all the things which I have spoken concerning his house. When I begin, I will also make it end, for I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knoweth, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not. Just be careful. We've got to be careful to restrain, because we are the ones that God has placed to protect them. Let's look at the last thing. Influence with the great spirit will have the greatest results. Remember, rules of that relationship will always breed rebellion. Rules and boundaries are needed in any relationship. Let me give you an example. Even in my marriage, there are some things I will do and I will not do. Why? Because I love my wife. That's not legalism. It's not my wife's evil. No, there's just certain things I will do and I will not do because I love her. She goes to bed. When Friday nights, I'll just chill, hang out, watch some TV. She usually goes to bed earlier than me. Because I love her, I don't walk in at 11:30, 12 o'clock and hit the light right above her and walk in and throw my shoes on the floor. I don't do that. Why? Because I value life, all right? I don't do that because I love my wife and I want her to sleep. Now, my wife is evil. She forces me to be quiet when I walk into the room. No, if I want to go to bed at 10 o'clock, I can go to bed at 10 o'clock and that'd be fine. I do it because I love her. There are things I will and will not do in relationship just because of that. It's not legalism. This must be done in the right spirit, though. Here's a couple thoughts. If a child believes that there's no way they will ever please their parents, I believe they will not try. If they've ever come convinced they cannot please their parents. Now, don't get me wrong. Here's why I've seen people, and teens can use this example. All right, every time you get on my case, today I can hear it at lunch today, all right? Pastor says you're on my case. I can't please you, so I'm not going to try. Teens, that's not what I'm talking about, all right? We'll just clarify that. Parents, I believe in setting a high standard of where you want your kids to be. I believe in making them work for things. I believe in saying you can do your best. Now, whether your best is an A in class or a C, you should work your best. If you can get A's and you're getting C's, I think you should work harder. Let me tell you that. If you can get A's and you're just barely getting by as a parent, I force you. Let's get some A's here. If your best is A's and B's, I'm glad you're getting A's and B's. I want you to work. I want to set high standards. I want there to be ethics. I want you to work hard. All of that. So there's going to be times when they're complaining, I don't want to cut the grass. Bummer. Go cut the grass. Why? Because I want to teach them that. Now, when they come to me and I go out after cutting the grass and I point to the 80% of the grass they didn't cut, I'm not making them look bad. I'm trying to teach them to complete a job. But if they never hear from me, hey, you did a great job with that. Man, I was a B, great job. You got a C, I know how hard you work for that C, good job. They've got to know this is the point when they have worked, that they have pleased the people they want to please more than anything. And that's their parents. So what do you do? Number one, be positive. Your spirit has a fantastically large influence on your child. I read this week and I thought it was a great point. A steady spirit brings security. A positive spirit brings joy. A prayerful spirit brings peace. What kind of spirit do we have in our home? Your attitude and your demeanor are constantly training and influencing your child. Let me give you an example. If you're always angry, you will have angry children. If you're critical of other people, if you complain about your boss all the time and your authority, your kids are going to complain about their authority, which is the teachers of school and you, because they've learned that from you. It's the spirit of which we do it. If you are calm in times of struggle, when life is all up in storms and you're calm, you teach them to trust in God. If you are encouraging, even when you're hurt, you're struggling, and in the middle of that, instead of complaining about all the battles, you're encouraging others, and in the midst of they see that. That makes a huge influence. Not only be positive, lastly, be prayerful. Colossians 1:9, for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of His will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Be prayerful. Be on your knees for those kids. There are some things you will teach them, but it's the Holy Spirit that will take that seed that you've placed upon their heart and will embed it and will make it something that becomes them. Be prayerful. Pray with them. Pray for them constantly. Every once in a while, I don't do this a whole lot, but every once in a while I'll catch them and I'll tell a kid, I'm praying for you. You say, why aren't you telling them about all the time? Because some of these I'm praying for, I don't think they know that I know that what's going on, what they're struggling with. So I'm praying for them. And I'm just praying specifically for a certain thing. Years ago, I listened to a preacher in a school chapel, and he was talking about how in his teen life, grew up in a Christian home, and he was struggling with certain things, and he was wrong, and he knew it, and there was just massive conviction. It was about 7 or 8 things the Lord had just really worked in his heart about. And finally, after weeks of just conviction, he finally came to the Lord, and he gave it to God, and he made a list of these certain amount of things, and he said, I'm done. He said, the nice thing was my parents didn't know anything about it, so I didn't have to tell them. It was just between me and God, no big deal. He said, a few weeks later, my mom said, hey, I need you to go get something from my room. It's in the top drawer of my dresser. And he pulled open, and there was whatever it was he was getting, and next to it was a prayer list with his name on it, with the dates. He pulled the prayer list on, and guess what was the eight things on that list? The eight things that he had given to God, and he had never told his mom. Prayer is more powerful than any screaming I can do. It's more effective. Be prayerful. Fight for them on their knees. Understand our children will have to decide for themselves what they will do with Jesus down the road. Can I give you a thought on this? Consider the man by the name of Moses. Hebrews 11:24. By faith Moses, when he was come to years, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season, esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasure in Egypt, for he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. You notice he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter or prince. He chose rather to suffer affliction with God's people than to enjoy the pleasure of sin for a season. This verse is something that every young person will have to choose to follow at some point. Here's a question. What have I done with that verse as a parent? What influence am I placing upon them? We have a great chance to help in that decision. This is a result of our influence. May we today take advantage of the time that God has given us. And by the way, you know what that might mean? For some of us, that might mean there are some things in our life that is wrong and we need to get it right. Because if we don't get it right, our kids are going to follow in our footsteps. There are things in my life I don't want my kids to follow. There's some personal struggles I have I don't want my kids to have. I have struggle. If people know when I'm mad, I get real quiet. Why? Because I'm easily annoyed. If I get frustrated, so I get real quiet. And my kid's like, oh no, he's quiet. Oh no, it's bad. You know, one of the key reasons I stay quiet, I don't want them, and I still struggle with it. I don't want them to grow up their entire life thinking every time they come home and don't put their bag where it's supposed to, they blow up. I don't want them to think that their bag is more important. I had an article, my wife showed it to me, and it's a great article. It was talking about a wife who would come home and she kept ripping into her son when he dropped the bag in the living room going home. Someone asked her something, and she goes, I never thought of this. She goes, he came in, he drops the bag in frustration, and as a parent, you're thinking, I'm so sick of you dropping the bag in the living room. And she goes, maybe he has just had four of the worst things happen to him today, and he's dropping the bag out of hurt and frustration. And instead of the parent finding out how was your day, the parent's more concerned about a stupid bag in the living room than they are about the struggles of the day. By the way, I don't think it's okay to dump your clothes anywhere. I know kids are going to say, I can have a filthy room. You got to be concerned about me. It's not what I'm saying, all right? But parents, when we see something out of the ordinary, or frustrating, let's go find out why. Let them talk about it. Because that influence, you let the kid go for a little bit, it's amazing what you can learn and the influence you can have. Parents, we have the greatest influence, the most important influence, and we need to take advantage of it. That might mean that I need to make some changes in my life. That might mean that I need to get some things right in my life. That means I may have to go home and apologize and say, I'm going to move forward. It's not about what happened yesterday. It's about tomorrow. The power of a parent's influence. Father, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity that we have this morning to look into your word. Lord, this young man, Timothy, relatively at his time, a very young pastor. As we know from 1 Timothy, he was looked down upon by many in his church because of his youth. Father, you told him,